Hello everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Hyrule Chronicles. This is episode 116. I am the Game Master, Articulate T. This is our Legend of Zelda Dungeons & Dragons campaign, and with me, as always, I have Never playing Renji Vox.
Hello! Stuff happened, don't worry, we're good!
I have Avarance playing Hikancio.
Hello.
I have Robopirate playing Zidanchari.
Hello there.
And I have Keistruth playing Max.
I managed to spend like almost one of each level spell slot last time. That's funny.
Nice. Nice.
Yeah. So, friends, what happened on the previous episode of Hyrule Chronicles?
Last time on Hyrule Chronicles, we hopped over into the middle of the Civil War, at least landmass-wise, looking for the trail of one Gorespire. After being unable to find him through the air, we followed the tracks that we were able to find in remnants of camp, eventually leading to a battlefield where many were killed, mostly Hylians, compared to the few Moblins that were there. We had an encounter with a Darknut who was willing to help and lend us an ear or to do whatever he was able to do, and which has included taking an injured Hylian back to Rudal Village, where he was assigned to protect, while we continued our way down to Gorespire, hot on his trail. The dread creeping up in Hikan as they got closer and closer to the monastery that he had spent 5 years before meeting the party in. When they got to the monastery, they found a pitched combat with Hikan's master and many monks defending the monastery from the forces of Gorespire and his moblins. Not thinking of subterfuge or strategy, Hikan shouted to the air as soon as he knew that Gorespire would hear him that he had something that Gorespire wanted, holding up the Quake Medallion. Hikan spent most of the time focusing on Gorespire, keeping his attention, while his companions took over all of the other moblins with the help of Gorin and the other monks. When the moblins were taken care of, the storm's eye converged on Gorespire until Hikan ended up taking his axe with all the energy, spell energy that it had stored in it, and cut Gorespire in half. I believe that was everything.
Yes. That is indeed everything. And so it is that we cut back to the quiet and tense, I suppose, aftermath of that battle. The fresh smell of ozone is thick in the area, considering the amount of lightning that had been falling around.
Sorry.
But as the onlookers rub their eyes and blink out the spots, they can we can see Hikan standing triumphant, the heavy axe still in hand, as the bisected corpse of Gorespire has been falls apart in two pieces, freshly singed from the sheer density of arcane lightning that he had been struck with. There's a pause as a light breeze blows over the now quiet locale. Each of the monks who remain standing straighten up, stretch out their muscles, and look about themselves to see if any more attackers might be on their way. All except one monk who props himself up onto his feet, having decided to hang back and watch his student well and truly vanquish such a deadly foe. And a broad smile is planted onto his lips as he totters over and in a kind of tipsy-ish line. It's definitely not a straight line, but
a circle.
Despite that, he manages to quite gracefully, in his own way, hop up onto the steps once again and walk calmly over to Hikan and say, never fail to impress. Welcome home.
It's helpful if I unmute. Hikan just gives him a hug.
Just like,
I was crunching on chips and I was like, wait, why didn't it pick up?
That's fine. It's okay.
Renji would have gone like, I mean, come on. This is the time when you speak.
He's right. Like, as you run up and hug him, he immediately returns the hug and pats you quite hard on the back. As the other monks kind of like assuring themselves that there are no further threats, begin helping the wounded back up into the monastery.
Max probably lands and turns back from dragon form. His staff is still active.
But yeah, the master, like, while he continues to hug Hikan as long as Hikan wishes it, and will look over to the rest of you while he does so and says,
so, I think I am owed a couple of stories from the looks of things.
I was just imagining, like, the hug not stopping, such as that waddle walk over towards us.
After a little bit, probably a couple of seconds after he says that, Hikan does let go. And then kind of more looking at the axe to figure out how to get the Aether Medallion out of it. Just kind of goes, okay, quick introductions real quick. He points to Renji and he goes, the fancy looking one is Renji, he's Nihilus's son.
Formal bow.
The blue one is Max. He's really cool. He's a little quiet sometimes, but he's really cool.
Ash just stands there and is looking at this guy like, who the fuck is this?
And then the quiet one over there is Zaiden. He's a druid, I think is what the word is.
Him a hand to shake.
He'll shake your hand heartily. Very firm, strong handshake.
And then the person over there that was helping with potions, that's Mara. Mara's very smart.
Hi.
And everyone in the Storm's Eye, this is Garin. He's the person that taught me most of the things I know.
Well, then I would really like to sample your cooking, sir.
I said most.
Cooking I don't do. However, if you're up for a stiff drink while we wait for a few things to happen, by all means, follow me. We'll probably want to. And he'll kind of wander over to the axe if it's still, like, in the ground and kind of just grasp onto it. And, like, with kind of lever fulcrum sort of thing, picks it up. Comedically almost teeters to one side as the weight of it becomes apparent, and then hefts it over his shoulders and says, I'm sure that there's, considering what has just happened, I expect one of those very formal and admittedly boring meetings will have to go down with some of the other masters, so best get our relaxation in beforehand.
why didn't you tell me everyone important likes the boring meetings? And I just start talking about all the stuff that we did at Castletown. Like, meeting things.
He just kind of like chuckles to himself slightly and says, well, you know how it works with folks. Sometimes you need to have a couple of hours of talking about nothing in order to claim you've gotten somewhere with it when you could have easily just sent a letter. And just kind of keeps walking up the steps.
Don't spend the hours talking about nothing. You have to do actual work.
I was going to say, as long as it's written down, that's what matters.
Important thing is that minutes are taken.
Matt just says, yeah, they are boring.
So Gorin will lead all of you into the, like, through the main stone gateway that exists through the into the side of the mountain almost. And along these kind of admittedly quite cramped paths before getting to this, I wouldn't say it's exactly like Kakariko, but it kind of opens up into a similarly hidden little spot where there are these humble little homes dotted around the place. There's plenty of basic farms and everything, but it's a bustle of activity now as a collection of monks are moving with speed and efficiency to try and tend to their wounded and pass messages along and everything. There are a couple of glances at all of you as you enter, because clearly there is a quartet of people who...
One of them has wings.
One of them has wings. and they don't recognize you in this area, but unlike Kakariko's initial reception, it's not as cold.
I don't get shot.
You don't get shot. You kind of get glanced at. If anybody looks at you for more than a couple of seconds, it's to size you up, not necessarily to be like, I can fucking take him. It's like, okay, what have you got? What potential things are you a threat? Categorized, back to work. And it's just...
I have 12 spell slots left. That's how dangerous I am.
That must be quite difficult to do in this universe. Where, like, okay, he looks like a normal old man, and now he's a bear. Shit.
I seem to have miscalculated.
One of their own, now trained in with experience.
Trained in cooking.
Trained in cooking as well. We have a half dragon sorcerer with wings. We have an older senior
old man with a stick.
Old man with a stick. And knight in shining armor.
You put a lot of effort into making it shiny.
Yeah. I've put a lot of effort into it.
Yeah. Amara.
The prestidigitation to keep it shiny is nearly subconscious.
Yeah.
I mean, what you can do if you want to, feel free to give me an insight check as to what it is that they might taking into account when sizing you up in such a fashion.
15!
Max would also like to do that.
Passive insight.
Because Max is, like, also keeping an eye on them to see if they want to fight us.
I'll kick their asses.
And my passive perception is 23, as usual.
What you note from this, even with a 15, it isn't, like, hostile. It's not a case of, like... Essentially, what they do is they first categorize what you're armed with. So if you've got, like, a... so you've got a stick, you've got a sword, you've got a shield, you've got this, that,
I've
this, that.
I've only got the hilt, but they have seen it in action These are the people that have seen us in battle. They just see the hilt.
It's kind of like it's more or less a sort of a flowchart idea that they've got. So if they see you with a sword that has no blade, then you've got then essentially instead of going like, why is that idiot carrying a broken sword? They're going like, okay, that is a sword with no blade. What does it do? That's an unknown. We need to keep that in mind. But then, essentially after that, they take in your temperament. And this is adjusted slightly based off of you walking with Gorin and Hikan, who is known to them. At this point, it's like a case of, okay, so you're walking with a level of confidence, and you're also walking with a trusted master. So it's not... So they don't see you like as a... Okay, so if you're here, you're here by invitation, or you're meant to be here, you're not here to attack us. Especially since you're walking in here without too much suspicion or caution after there was a big colossal fight at our front gate. So clearly you're not on bad terms with us. It's a very swift assessment that they do this with. And most of what they are doing is, when they go back to work, is they're tending to wounds, they're checking supplies, they're checking maps and just kind of talking to one another. Although with all this kind of efficiency and everything, it's clear that a lot of that happens because of the recent attack on the gate. And they are aware that they are sitting on the edge of a still active war front. So it's... There's a kind of like a keep it to business, but does not necessarily mean like make a like be dour, be all business all the time. There is a little bit of levity here and there. There are the occasional, like, you can see children playing, you can see a couple of other like farmers or other workers just casually chatting as they go through this process. But it's otherwise a nice little place if a bit out of the way. And very self-sufficient, I think, is a good tag for this place. As you walk, Gorin, who's still kind of like, he's walking slowly and not in a straight line still, and he's just kind of like saying,
So, just as a brief aside, nothing out of the ordinary other than the recent happenings has happened here. We've been trying to find our own set of mystical whoozits every so often. It just hasn't come up yet, I suppose. Or at least no immediate sightings. But that can be discussed properly with the other masters.
Mm-hmm. Forgive me, Master Garon. I'm not familiar with the workings of this monastery. Could you explain how?
Much like your clan in Kakariko, we also work to protect the kingdom and the royal family in our own way. We work with diplomats and scouts and medics when it comes to the most immediate area, but also there is a matter of searching through Hyrule's vast and often complicated history and looking for things that might cause a bit of a stir. And he shifts the shoulder that he's resting the axe on as an indication as to this sort of thing.
There's a nod from Renji as he says that.
Which, by the way, good work on that front. Not one but two medallions. That's impressive, I must say.
Yeah, I didn't really have to worry about this for too much. It was on a dinosaur on an island in the middle of the ocean.
Okay, it's we have like tale. 30 minutes at least before we have to sit down with the other masters. Come, we'll find a table. You're telling me everything you can.
I would and... like to use performance.
Eventually, like, he finds like a nice table out front of one of the taverns. I wouldn't say it's like an official tavern spot. It's just a place where food and drink can be served, and they have he finds a nice suitable table, sits everybody down, props the axe against the wall, and it's like he's being quite cavalier, almost careless with this thing, but it's right, and gestures over to a server and says, I'll have the usual, please, and turns to look at all of you expectantly, like, do you all want anything at all on your own, or are you happy to remain as sober as you possibly can?
I think for now that might be the best for me personally.
Do not give me alcohol.
You're more likely to, like, burn it, aren't you?
It's...
That just stares.
Understandable. As much as I like to enjoy it myself, I'm not gonna push that sort of thing onto anyone else, if I'm honest. How about you two over there? And he looks to Zaiden and Mara.
Is Artie Robody or is I'm Robody?
I think it might be you.
I'm Robody.
Oh. Oh no. Okay. But yeah. So while we wait for Hikon to come back.
And Robo was also VR being.
Welcome back. Are you still roboting?
I am not.
That's fine.
And everyone else seems pretty stationary or pretty good about it.
Good.
Yep. And he's back.
Awesome. Welcome back. Goran will look over to Zaiden and Mara and say, either of you want a drink at all?
Zaiden will take a drink.
Okay. Any preference?
Do you have a speciality?
He smiles wide. And he looks over to say, make that two of my usual, please. And, miss? And Mara says,
No, I think I'll be okay for now. Thank you, though.
I don't know, narrow his eyes at the man and say, do I need to brace myself?
Yes. You prepped that thingy that you do that helped me get sober, right?
That's harder to do on myself.
Oh dear. After that he'll look to you kind of say, would you like anything to drink?
I think I'm okay for now.
Very well. And after a moment, the server will come over with two cups and a gourd that looks to be coloured in blacks and reds. They pour out some sake for you, Zaiden, and some for Goran, and they leave the bottle on the table. The sake has this kind of interestingly sweet aroma to it, and it is it's still quite clear, but it also has a kind of like red tint to it almost.
Aiden will take a small sip of it first.
Okay. It is a wonderfully tasty drink. It is almost Moorish. You know when you get like a kind of drink where you intend to take a sip and then eventually like it's more gulps and everything. It doesn't force you to do that by any means, but it's Moorish to describe it. However, after a little bit of time, as it hits your system, I would like a constitution saving throw if you could.
13?
Okay. So the first thing that hits you is a sense of, like, it's hard to focus on any one point. Things go a tiny bit blurry around your peripherals, and what's in the focus point of your vision feels like it's moving away from it. You get this kind of pleasant buzz that runs through your throat all the way down to your stomach, and the tips of your fingers go tingly. You're still able to hear and recognize everything. It's just that it is quite clear that whatever this is, it's incredibly strong. Probably not as strong as Goron Rot, but then again, Goron Rot to anything that isn't a Goron is literal poison, so it's like
I recollect this.
Goran downs his drink almost like a shot and then puts it to one side and then turns to the rest of you and says, "So, how about you regale me with the tales of your exploits? I've only gotten so much from Hikan's letters here."
"Well, at the time this happened, we had already traveled the land, experiencing many things and going on many adventures. And as I start to get into this conversation, like this performance, I would actually like to use one of my new abilities, which is called Panache. I can use an action to roll a persuasion check versus a creature's insight check. And if they are not hostile to me, they are charmed for a minute."
Fair enough.
And I only want to do this like to make the performance more empathetic and more emphatic, sorry.
Yeah.
So that's a 24.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm doing this against a master monk.
The 220 pretty good at wisdom.
Yeah, I know. So I'm curious.
Let's see. So what does he? Does he have to roll anything? Sorry.
Contested persuasion versus insight.
Oh.
Hmm.
Interesting. Okay. 30.
Very, very nice. So he knows, like, I'll put this in, like, this is what I'm doing. And especially like the last bit. So he will probably know that I'm trying to do this.
It's hard to tell at first because like he sits and listens. It's clear that he's enraptured. So, from Renji's perspective, it's difficult to note whether or not it worked or if it didn't. But he just wants to listen in anyway. So he kind of like sits and listens and occasionally interjects with a couple of questions and stuff to ask for elaboration and stuff. And like occasionally when like exploits of your heroic battles and deeds that include Hikan more specifically, he'll give Hikan a bit of a nudge. Like an encouragement, like, that's exactly what I trained him for.
For specifically this person, I will try and put more emphasis on like what Hikan was doing at that time. Because, like, I'm trying to impress this guy on behalf of Hikan.
Yeah. He's enraptured. Like, as he listens, he's kind of, like, stroking a scruff on his chin.
The only thing Max says, if it does come up, is that he will, like, try and nudge the conversation away from anything about him and Torquin.
I think we were talking mostly about our trip to Ixan and the Steel Isle.
I don't know how much we're going to get through in 30 minutes, is the thing.
That's fair. Like, Renji would focus mostly on like acquiring the metal.
Yeah.
It's also the fact that if Renji is putting, for lack of a better term, panache on it, and between Renji and Hikan's way of telling stories, which is very roundabout, it will probably get one story in the 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Other than Max doesn't say anything and just kind of lets you guys talk.
You kind of just sit and listen for a little while, and then eventually, as the half hour goes by, one of the younger initiates pokes his head around and says, "Master Goran, sir," and he bows and
Garen kind of looks over. There's like, he's still pleasant. It's just that there's a kind of a whisper. Like, oh, I was listening to that.
that was having fun.
Yeah. There's a, the others will need to speak. As...
don't worry. Run along. We'll take care of that now. Thank you for the story. We'll definitely have to continue that later. In the meantime, we need to go do the boring part of all of this.
Stands up, once more hefts the axe onto his shoulder. He says,
follow me. We will hopefully make this fairly quick.
He will lead all of you out of the tavern area, further up through the tiers of this settlement, of this grand looking place, where there's a very good view over the rest of the settlement, and especially pointing back out to the northeast, where just over the peaks of the mountain tops and like little rocky climbs, you can see just the rolling plains of Hyrule Field once again, where it is where the war continues onwards. Goran will carefully kind of like slowly lead you into this area through a couple of corridors, eventually into this big room, dark room, where the air is almost unnaturally still. There's as you enter, you can see that there are a total of 7 fairly high chairs, with one slightly taller than the others. All of them have occupants except for one, but that is soon filled as Goran, gesturing you to stay on the opposite side of the room for now, places the axe in the middle of this little group and then takes his seat. The one person at the center, a fairly kind of, like, one could say almost the polar opposite in physical appearance to Goran, looks to Goran and says, you're late, Master Goran. And Goran just waves a hand and says, I'm never late. And hops up onto the chair.
He arrives precisely when he means to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And says,
I know a guy like that.
The monk in the center rolls her eyes and looks over to all of you and says, well, welcome to our little slice of the world. I think it goes without saying that we are thankful for your intervention when it came to the Moblin attack at the gate moments ago. What you have done is you have saved a lot of lives. And from what we understand it, have vanquished quite the evil. And also provided us with something that is quite important. And she'll look over to Hikan. Hikan, you know this as... if I need to get the note up so I can pronounce the name correctly.
Yeah, go for it.
Faisali, I think, is the one. She kind of looks to you, Hikan, and says, I would like it if you might be able to furnish us with the brief summary as to your time during your adventures, especially considering what has been provided back to us in your recent journey under the tutelage of one Master Goran, if that is okay.
So compared to the last time that Hakan was in this room, he is much more relaxed, and it feels a lot smaller than it did beforehand, because it used to be like really big and empty. And now he's there, and he's just kind of like, if you could do this slowly, he's like, ah, shit. But what he does is, at least in response to the aspects of his mission, he keeps things focused. He mentions first meeting Gorspire in Drumnik and how Gorspire was able to tear a rift using the Aether Medallion to get away. And then he mentions was it the Isle of Ixon that was over there?
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's the Sealed Isle. So then he mentions the Isle of Ixon and the Helmasaur King, which is where the Quake Medallion came from, as he takes the Quake Medallion out and puts it on there. And then as he got to a point where he figured out where Gorspire was with the help of his friends, he came over to the area between Vessel and Rudol and tried to cut Gorspire off, but Gorspire was ahead. And then he waits for about 10 seconds and goes, "Oh, wait, no, I got this too." And he pulls out the Book of Mudora. "I got this from a birdman who sold pets."
There's kind of a, like, Aizali kind of nods as she examines everything over. Everyone else in the room remains fairly stoic. There's only one that kind of narrows his eyes slightly.
That reaction, I will chime in saying, he's on our payroll at the moment.
The individual who narrowed their eyes, this gaunt fellow who seems to have, like, each of these people in this room have their own little things that almost signify them. Like, Faizali themselves seems to just be a poise, crisp composure, almost seems to glow slightly. The squinting man appears to have, like, shadows that gather around him. There's another woman who appears to be almost, like, subtly burning, like just this aura of subtle flames that sit around them.
As if each of them have a different monk subclass.
And they all have this kind of aura of reverence around them. They all seem otherworldly, except for Goran, who appears to be the same kind of pleasant, disheveled old man that you met when you arrived here. Like, even sitting in the chair, as unkempt and, like, undignified as he is, he seems the most human out of all of them, but that doesn't necessarily portray any kind of weakness on his part.
You saw what he did to those moblins.
I am more worried for him in a fight than I would be of any of the others, I think.
the squinting man, this gaunt fellow with the shadows around him, he leans forward slightly, and with a brow raised, he looks to you, Hikan, and says, "And what of the third medallion? Have you any record as to where that one might be?"
Not at the moment, no. I'm still looking for it.
I see. And Goran rolls his eyes and says,
"Like I said before, you did good. Don't let any of these stuffy individuals say otherwise. The fact that we've got two at the moment is incredible work. After all, one you found on an island across the sea, another you found in the possession of a moblin. It's not exactly going to be easy to identify where the others might dwell. And the book, in its own right, that's quite the find. It's a lost annals of history you have there."
Hikon nods.
Faizali will say, "Yes. Though I suppose there is something of an elephant in the room, or I suppose within the kingdom. A unique problem that may impede on
the search for the remaining medallion, as well as any artifacts that might be found within the book that you have provided. One of the other monks, this thin, pale individual, is almost kind of ghost-like in their own demeanor, looks over and says, "Ah, yes, of course. As you may be aware, in your own variety of ways, we are not ignorant of all the happenings that exist within the kingdom and beyond. We have been made aware of the efforts of one cartel, as well as a variety of other problematic things. The most paramount of which, from what we believe, would be this death cult that is quite active as of late."
Yeah. About that. And then Hikon will actually tell them as succinctly as he can about the Twilight Cartel and how Cassandra is the only one left, and there we are planning on helping with that. And then I'll tell them about the I do the made brief thing about the Sovereign Hand, because the cult itself is, while it is the kind of the thing, it's just a tool of the Arbiter type of thing. Yeah. And I think Hikon will focus more on what he knows about the Arbiter instead.
Not the Arbiter.
Nazgradar, because the Arbiter Nazgradar is downed.
Yeah, we kicked the shit out of the Arbiter.
Yeah.
Nazgradar.
Yeah. So they'll kind of, like, nod as they listen. And when the explanation is given, Faizali will look to either side of them to the rest of the congregation and says, "Well, I suppose that is going to be something of the case. It is a rather complicated matter. We shall not act on Cassandra ourselves. As much as I am aware that it is our role to protect the kingdom, I do believe... I mean, well, actually, before she says that, do you explain, like, what Risha's stance on the whole Cassandra and the rest of the West is? Or do you keep that quiet for now?
I have no reason to keep things from these people unless the rest of them tell me to, or give me a means to be quiet. I'll inform them about Risha's view on that.
Okay. So Faizali will say, "We have faith in the Lady of Defense for the kingdom to be able to handle this diplomatically as she might. And of course, if there is a need that arises for us to intervene, we shall. But for the moment, I believe that it is unfortunate stalemate that will need to remain as such. As for the cartel, if it is only remaining with Cassandra, then that more or less ties it with the rest of the fate of the war. As for this cult and this creature that leads them, that is the main problem. Leon, what do you make of this?" And the woman, who seems to be subtly burning in the background, looks and says,
quietly
smoldering,
combusting.
Yeah.
If Carlette can do it, she can do it too.
Yep.
I know. But Carlette is not in Zelda. Karlak is not in Hyrule.
Yeah.
Nor unless someone builds it.
Yeah.
We have Hyrule Chronicles 2 for that.
Leanne will turn to the other and say, well, that is quite the predicament, at least from what I can understand. I think it is best, considering their role in it already, that the search for further artifacts for the moment should be put to rest for now, at least on their behalf. We will continue doing what we do, but we must allow for this greater, more present threat to be dealt with. The gaunt man shakes his head and says, no, that's far too risky. If there is if the Bombos medallion is still active and in play in the world of Hyrule, that needs to be recovered before such an entity is able to acquire it. We cannot allow it to be left out in the open like that. I mean, the Aether medallion was in the possession of a simple moblin, and look at the damage that he was doing. What about this Nazgradar, master of the arcane of such a variety, would be far more potent with something of that. And another person, this larger individual who carries what appears to be like a, you know, one of those Shaolin bell spade staves. They have that just in their grasp at all times, and they say, No, this is far more pressing of a matter. If they were able to identify the medallion, they would have found it by now. We would have been having reports of explosions left, right, and center. No, this needs something else. Then the pale ghost-like woman says, well, if that's the case, then do we keep these here? Of course, they are powerful artifacts. They would be very helpful when it comes to dealing with an entity of such a variety. And at that, the whole room, excepting Goran and Faizali, break into a rather dignified, low volume, but still quite animated argument as to what to do about these medallions. Goran just kind of rolls his eyes slightly and like his fingers drum on the sake bottle that's at his waist, and Faizali remains the crisp picture of composure as she closes her eyes and takes in every statement from every direction as it goes on.
Ikon's tapping his foot and just waiting.
Max's eyes glazed over like 10 minutes ago. He has not been listening. He's like, yeah, I know all this shit. It's fine. I don't need to listen.
Yeah.
May I interject? I say my voice probably carrying a little bit, though not probably as much as, you know, acoustically placed chairs there.
It doesn't die down immediately, but Faizali raises a hand. And everyone, even those who are not looking at Faizali, will stop and turn to her, then turn to you, Renji. And Faizali will say, what do you have in mind?
We, as the Storm's Eye, have responsibilities that answer only to the royals. I understand that while Hikan is a member of your monastery, has lived here, has trained here, has had your support, this task that you've set him on, he has already, in my estimation, fulfilled to even beyond what was asked of him in the first place. Hikan is not the only member of your monastery. We have several things that are asked of us that we are tasked to do at this time. We will be looking out for this third medallion, certainly. We will not leave it by the wayside if we happen to find it. But with the state of the war, with the state of the kingdom at this moment, I cannot say that it is reasonable for us, or specifically for Hikan even, to put down everything and go looking for it.
The other aspect about it is, and Hikan will kind of shrug off the left shoulder of his robe to show, well, both by proxy the tattoo, but the scars that run down his arm. He goes, in order to take care of Nazgradal, we need the same type of thing that someone would be able to use with the medallions in order to use them as we were was suggested with the Bombos medallion all the time. Gorspire had to have a lot of healing potions in order to get that through, but and Hikan kind of lifts his arm to the best of his ability without combat or adrenaline rushing through. It's not easy to withstand. And there's nothing saying that we won't run into it when we find the other one or an item to get rid of Nazgradal.
No luck. It'll probably be hidden in the desert sands and we'll just stub our toe against it.
It's easy to drop it off then.
There's a pause as they all consider that. And Goran will kind of Goran's already kind of made his decision. Like the moment you finish talking, he's already made his decision, and he kind of looks expectantly at the others. And when there's a substantial pause, he leans forward and says with some level of confidence, and "Well, how about this then? So we can assume and surmise the facts that we're all available for." Master Vox is correct. We do have other agents that are available in order to find the final medallion while they are taking care of other equally important matters. Even before he finishes a sentence, he raises a hand to stop the gaunt man, Master Daito, from speaking to object, so he can continue.
Even more important!
he says, as you can see, they've gone through a lot in order to get this far, and this already an impressive haul from the looks of it. If the medallions are dangerous for any mortal kind to use without aid in some fashion, then of course they're looking to be able to channel it through some kind of divine focus of some variety. Which means, for the most part, the use of these medallions is limited to those who either have the constitution to withstand it or have those implements already on hand.
Force of will, actually.
Hmm?
Force of will, actually.
I see. If that's the case, then we will only have to fear somebody like this Nazgradal acquiring this amulet for themselves specifically. But from what we can gather about witches of this variety, exploded bodies do not make for good subjects for reanimation. So perhaps he will see no real use in it, at least for the most part. The question, I think, is on everybody's minds when it comes down to this, is whether or not these fine individuals take a medallion with them
as a suitable weapon when it comes to dealing with this entity. I can understand from the looks of each of one of you that you have your own concerns as to whether a medallion falls into the wrong hands. But sometimes desperate situations call for desperate measures. And I would like to put my vote that they would be capable of taking one of these medallions with them. They will not be far, I suppose. They found us already, and they had acquired a medallion and kept it on their person for how long?
That is an excellent question. The days have been kind of living together.
I don't know.
Ever since you found it, I suppose.
An amount of time.
There is, in my mind, there is no question as to their capability and how much trust we can put to them to continue this. The question is, though, it is a last resort as far as they have it. It is a difficult thing to consider, I know. Perhaps, then, we might consider outfitting them with something that can alleviate that burden. Mm-hmm. And Faizali will kind of nod a little bit and says, unfortunately, we do not have the specific implement that would allow its continued use without any form of repercussion, but we can provide something that is somewhat of a facsimile. It will take some time to put together, but it does come down to something of a vote. Master Garin has already provided his. As per my role as head of this council, I will withhold my vote for last.
I would like to say one more thing before the votes are cast. When we were going to the Sealed Isle, which is an isle north of the one where I found the Quake Medallion, the Quake Medallion was a key to get there. I do not know if any other places made by our people or otherwise have had such keys with these medallions as well. That may or may not help us in either getting information or getting tools to help defeat Nazgûl.
Something definitely worth to be considered. In the meantime, we'll commence the vote of whether the Storm's Eye can maintain possession of one of the medallions. She looks to her left and says, Lashti, if you'd like to cast your vote. Lashti, this shorter than everybody else, but is quite lithe, glows in a similar but not the same manner as Faizali, considers for a moment, and then raises the hand and says, I am in favor.
Do they glow astrally?
Somewhat. Like there's, yeah. I suppose, yeah. And then Faizali nods and says, May of the Long Death, would you prefer to cast your vote now? May nods and considers and shakes her head. Says, I believe it is too great of a risk. I believe it should stay here where we can keep it safe. Faizali nods again, turns to the large man with the bell spear and says, Master Goro, what is your vote? And Goro considers and says,
I am with May. I believe it is far too great of a risk.
Faizali nods and turns to Daito and says, and your vote, Master Daito? And immediately Daito shakes his head and says, I think it should stay here, and it should be kept under greater lock and key while the remaining medallion is looked for. And she nods, says, Goran, you've already cast your vote.
And then she turns to the smoldering woman and says, Leanne, yours? Leanne says, I'm in favor. They should be able to take the medallion. It is a valuable weapon, and it is a darker time that is ahead of us from what I can imagine. They would need all the help they can get. And Faizali nods and says, then the final vote does in fact come to me. He considers it for a moment and says, I find myself in favor of them taking a medallion. Question is, which one would you prefer? I know that from your report you have experience with the Quake medallion, but, well, you've seen the extent of what the Aether medallion can do as well. I leave that decision to you.
If we're concerned with it being a key, would it make more sense that there's more locks with the Quake medallion, or that there would be different locks with the Aether medallion?
It's different locks, because you used the Quake medallion to open up Turtle Rock in A Link to the Past, and you used the Aether medallion to open up Misery Mire.
Yeah, but Zyda wouldn't know that.
No. I was about to say, can I, Alverin, roll an insight on Artie the DM to see if there's any medallion keys going forward?
Sure, DC 50.
DC 50? Alright, cool.
I was going to suggest bribing with chocolate, but...
It's a bit far away for that.
I mean, we can send stuff. I am certain.
I think I'm only like an hour away from him right now.
Hell. Okay, so above the table, Max's thing is lightning, so do we want to keep it, like, do we want to double up on that, or?
Up to you.
I think...
That they
are used separately as keys, and we've already used one. We'd want to keep the Aether medallion.
I think Renji would go along with that line of logic.
Okay.
Max is fine with whatever you want to go with, and is definitely not staring at the Aether medallion.
It's not a book.
Yeah, but he's drawn to lightning stuff.
You know, I'll go ahead and take the Aether medallion then. The logic in regards to the keys and Max's interest in this one, maybe Max will help me with this one. Just as a thought.
MaxNet, how do they work?
Max doesn't have the intelligence to answer that question.
Look, if Max is attracted to the medallion, I'm wondering if there's some magnetism involved.
Again, Max does not have the intelligence to answer this question.
Mm-hmm. That's
fair. If you express interest in the Aether medallion, Faizali will nod and say, it will take a little bit longer time in order to remove it from its housing, but we will provide you with the medallion in time, as well as a suitable way to circumvent the more dire aspects of it. In the meantime, thank you for your counsel. We have a lot more to discuss in private, but for the moment, feel free to make yourselves at home. We have a lot to discuss, and we will return to you in due time.
Okay. And I'll just casually turn towards the storm side and we'll lead them out.
Yeah. That's like math internally, finally it's over.
You are led outside back into the little little village in the mountains, and you you have some time before they finish their work. You see a couple of others, like a couple of guards, actually move in to then take the take the axe between them in order to take it to the nearest possible blacksmith, who will then do their best to retrieve it from this scrap metal weapon.
Just hit it with hammers till it falls out.
Worth a go. But yeah, so you have a little bit of time. Is there anything you want to do or specifically need to do prior to them returning to you with the medallion?
Probably rest.
I think Hakan shows them around. Hakan will take them to, for lack of a better term, the barracks, because he was one that showed people where they slept beforehand. And as a whole, they're kind of modest rooms, a desk, a bed. They're not cramped or anything. Just it's like a dorm, a studio type of thing. But you know, he just kind of shows people around and takes people back to go get food. And if people want to rest or go do other things, Hakan is gonna go show some of the other monks some of his neat mercy shit, where he can help them learn to heal with their ki.
Nice. Is that something that's completely new?
That is something that Hakan figured out how to do on his own, thus the subclass change, but I don't know if it's necessarily completely new.
It would be cool. It's like, hey, I've traveled the lands and came up with this entire new discipline.
Hey, check this shit out.
Yeah
pretty much. Yeah. That's more like what Hakan's doing.
But Renji's there in the background, like, serenading.
Yeah, it's clear that this is not, if there has been any instance of others utilizing their ki in order to heal someone, then it hasn't come up a lot. Because you remember from your time here, most of the monks have been trained formally in like first aid and basic life support and all that kind of stuff. They are there to keep someone from dying on the battlefield until they can be dragged back to somewhere to be healed properly. And so them watching you utilize your ki in order to mend wounds and do that more effectively is quite the sight. In fact, they probe a lot of questions, and the one that they bring up a lot is Master Mei. Who is a practitioner of the Way of Long Death. So they utilize their ki in a similar fashion so that they basically are semi-immortal. Mm-hmm. But because that's entirely based within themselves, it's the best point of comparison they have.
What Hakan does when that's kind of brought up is he kind of nods for a little bit and he actually goes, actually, it's more akin to stunning another individual. It's just, rather than stopping it or blocking it in its tracks, you encourage it and pull it forward type of thing. I get it's tough.
And they kind of get that. The initiates that you're speaking to kind of like nod along, and they manage to pass it. And even start kind of just watching you carefully in order to try and do the same thing themselves, though with very limited success. It's difficult to master a technique like that within the scope of like 5 minutes.
You don't say.
Yeah, it does. With Renji serenading in the background, it does draw something of a crowd, and there's quite a lot of people who are sitting and watching you as you kind of go through this impromptu lesson and lecture over the usages of this sort of stuff. And I will say it's been like a good half hour over this course of time, or possibly even an hour. So if you wanted a long rest and press your long rest buttons, you can do. Short rest buttons.
I do want to press the short rest button, thank you.
Yeah. Eventually someone else comes up, a monk who was who saw on the way in, who would stand by the main gate, wanders up and says, excuse me, you are Hikan Seo, correct?
Do I recognize his voice?
You don't, actually. Someone completely okay. new.
that's me.
There's someone outside who wishes to speak with you and your friends, if possible.
Tall, Gerudo, redheaded, lots of armor.
We can't tell because of the armor.
Shiny gloves?
Everything about them is shiny.
I thought they'd be shinier. Okay. I'll just start heading over. He's got the silver gauntlets.
I mean, true, but this could also be a dark nut.
This could be a dark nut.
Is it a dark nut?
Would
this person know that if
they're a bit short for a dark nut.
Okay.
As you are led outside and you see, like, standing at the top of the stairs, you see at the very bottom appears to be a chariot that is attached to two horses, and the chariot itself seems to be very reinforced and slowly, loudly clanking up the stairs. Appears to be a humanoid figure in very heavy, very bulky looking armor, with a great axe that is strapped to their back.
Iron knuckle armor?
Yeah.
So you've seen that before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It called me Tyrena because Gerudos famously do not have horses.
impossible to refute logic here.
He kind of gets like halfway up and stops for a moment. Your passive insight allows you, and perception allows you to see the slightest shoulder sag. It's like, and they look up and see you, and they pause for a moment, and they kind of like gesture you to come over.
No extra stairs.
Hikan's just like, how do I want to play this? Hikan, I believe it's Tyrena, but I don't think Hikan's that cool at the moment. It was going to be like, okay, so they made it that many steps up, I'll take that many steps down.
I will say I have a passive perception of 23.
Yeah, that's fine. Like, you see, you can basically tell that, like, the way their body language indicates, they've climbed up a decent amount of stairs, but they are wearing what looks to be 250 pounds worth of metal. So it's...
That's terrible armor! That's not how armor should function! So I don't know why!
Yeah, they'll kind of wait for you to get onto the same level.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, they'll reach up and they'll take off their helmet. And Tyrena just kind of looks at you with this very, fairly kind of exasperated smile. And says, Design flaws. Hi.
Hi.
Good?
Yeah. It's just this.
An upgrade?
Upgrade, kind of. It's, can't be hurt. Can't really move. It's what the, she kind of like thumbs back over to the chariot and is like, that is necessary for a long distance. Hi! I'd hug you, but I'm like a barrel right now.
Yeah,
It takes half an hour to get out of this thing, let alone into it. Look, so hi, it's good to see you guys again. Mm-hmm. What did you need me for? Mind if we sit out here for a little bit while I get my breath back?
Sure.
You need
sure.
help with, you know, removing a helmet or?
Well, I mean, I've got the helmet off. I can breathe and see you guys, but it's gonna take a while to get all this stuff off. I'm thankful for these, and she'll gesture a hand, and like, it was difficult to tell at first because the armor is somewhat of a similar shade of silver that the mm-hmm. golds are, but she still has them. Yeah, it's a lot to move in. It's like wielding a two-handed weapon one-handed. It's a lot of balance issues.
But so why wear it?
Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Max.
So why wear it?
Part of training for a while. There's a lot of older, more traditional methods that this comes with than we had a more... She pauses a moment and says... pleasant relationship with the Dark Nuts, but I digress.
Also, Max has been standing a bit more of a distance away and seems to be trying to hide the wings.
She hasn't noticed much. Like, she has, if there are any visual differences since the last time...
Oh, they're very hard to hide. If she was paying attention, she would probably see them.
Yeah. Like, if she's noticed any visual changes in any of you, she hasn't deemed it necessary to bring it up. But she kind of, like, clatters a little bit and looks over and sees Mara and says, "Oh, hi, you must be Mara." Because she's never really met Mara in person before. And it's just like, they shake hands. And it's like...
Mara was the next DMPC.
Yeah.
So Torino's the ex.
Right. So, fill me in. What's happened?
Does this look familiar to you? And I pull out the drawing of the tower.
And she, like, there's a... and she leans forward as much as she dares to peer at the picture. Roll something for her. What is a survival like? Not bad. She kind of notes. She nods a little bit and says, "I think I remember those rock formations. Don't usually get towers in the middle of the desert."
We need to get there.
Right. Okay. Well, I can serve as something of a guide. It's just whether or not you'll be able to get into the desert yourself. The only person I can probably say would be able to go in there without having to be checked by the guards would be Mara here. But that can be arranged. I'll have to walk with you back to Garuda Fortress first. I know that you're all very capable in your own right, and you can probably just go around, but it's a matter of discourse, I suppose. The desert is big and hard to navigate, and full of very large and dangerous things. It's not a pleasant place by any stretch of the imagination. But it also would not be a good idea to be found by any kind of scout of our people and then be considered an enemy of the Gerudo for trespassing on what might be considered sacred territory. It's a complicated mess of problems. I'm sorry.
Which would be why I sent you a letter. Remember Kakariko?
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we need to talk to the king and get you, like, an official apology of some sort. for that.
I don't think it's a king.
Nowadays we can. I don't think if we told you that we are now barons of the kingdom.
It's a bit more complicated than that. And besides...
No, I mean like getting you an apology from Kakariko.
Oh, don't worry about it. It's honestly fine. Really, you don't have to, like, she has to speak a little louder as she moves, like, to, like, talk with her hands a bit.
Rattle, rattle.
So you know that video, there's a really short video which is titled Why Heavy Armor Has Disadvantage in Stealth, and it's a woman who is walking up a path in plate singing something, but you can't really hear anything because it's just the clatter of her armor.
Yeah.
it's that.
It's not as heavy as you think it is, but it is loud.
Yeah. Yep.
You cannot be sneaky in it.
Imagine pots and pans clanging together.
Yeah.
Now, do that, but then with, you know, strips and plates of metal. It's,
with every step, you just hear an entire kitchen rattling around.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There are ways to make it quieter, but yeah, on its own. On its own, it's pretty loud.
Yeah.
But, Yeah, no, it's kind of like as Renji is just kind of like, it's apology, and Turian is just like, no, it's okay. Khan's like, yeah, they're both secretive peoples. It's fine. It is what it is.
We understand.
Sucks, but it is what it is.
Yeah. Masses are like, I just didn't like getting shot at.
I understand that.
But yeah. And she'll kind of think about it a moment and says, We can go as soon as you're ready, I suppose. It's difficult to... It's not like one of those hyper-formal things where you have to say, like, send a letter in advance and get an RSVP, and it's... We can go in. So long as you're with me, then they will be fine. They won't be as aggressively questioning you, I suppose.
Meanwhile, Renji is just thinking, how much mithril do we need for a full plate armor set?
Do you want mithril your own done. Iron knuckle mithril armor?
No. Renji is accustomed to half plate. Mithril half plate. That gives him no disadvantage on stealth and that sort of thing.
It'd be really
Mithril full plate.
It'd be really funny to have silent Iron Knuckle armor.
It might also not come with the speed penalty because it's mithril and it's really light.
Yeah. Well, it's still bulky and in the way, so it might slow you down a little bit, but not as much.
Yeah.
See, while mithril full plate is one thing, mithril iron knuckle armor is another step above that.
So the way I can describe it,
Manny can like forge that.
Yeah.
Nah, you'd need that. Manny would need to work with a Gerudo smith to make that happen.
The way I can describe it is kind of like this. So, and if asked, Tyrena will explain the mechanics of what Iron Knuckle armor does, and by extension what Darknut armor is and everything like that. Basically, what she's wearing is a full set of chainmail, which is underneath a set of ablative plates. Essentially, the armor works as if when struck, it crumples like a car crumple zone in order to distribute the force and provide no damage to the person underneath. And then, when the plates are like fully broken away and everything, suddenly you become really light and able to move, so enemies are surprised by your sudden burst of speed. But the
phase
thing is,
two,
and you can just that... switch out the plates when
you
finish the fight.
Yeah.
Does it look like this is a full undamaged set?
It is. Yeah, it hasn't been touched. Okay. It's The way I can describe in the inconvenience of its mobility is, so there is a difference between types of plate mail. So you have the plate mail you wear while you are on foot, and you have the plate mail that you wear when you're on horseback,
because that one is heavier and less mobile, and you are lowered onto your horse, the cavalry armor.
You don't have to walk in there, ever.
Yeah. And that's more or less this, in similar kind of way. A bit more mobile, because you can move your legs and stuff, but it's like, it's still super duper heavy.
Makes sense.
But yeah, after a moment, like, Taurine has gotten much of her energy back from the first flight of stairs and says, okay, as I say, I'm ready to leave whenever you want to leave for Gerudo Valley. It depends on how long you want to get moving, or how quickly you want to get moving.
We do have to wait on something from here. But there's... The only thing I know that they serve here is alcohol. They probably serve other things in the way of beverages and food. But if you're with us, we can probably get you something for nourishment.
I think I'll just take a... If there's water, I'll take water. I don't think it's a good idea for me to drink an horse at this time.
No, that's fair. That's fair. I probably also wasn't going to, you know, partake.
But yeah, she will, if led back up, it'll take her a while, but she will join you guys back into the general area of this monastery. She strikes up a brief conversation with Mara, asking like a couple of probing questions as to like, how's the trip been going? Are you taking care of the idiots for me? That sort of thing.
I resent that.
And yet it doesn't make it any less true.
I have read a lot of books and put that into practice also.
But yeah, and Mara is, she tries to answer, though she's not, like, it's not like she's scared of Tyrena, it's just that she's not feeling terribly talkative, but Tyrena takes that in stride. She doesn't, like, try and badger her for any more information on top of that, she just kind of takes what information she can get, and gives nice long gaps where she's not the center of attention, that sort of thing. More or less like the same way that in casual conversation with like Max, when first meeting Max, probably handled the same way, like just kind of like give appropriate bit of breaks of space, that sort of thing.
Speaking of, Max does slip away once we get back inside to just, it's kind of a bit standoffish ever since Darren has gotten back.
Oh.
And it's just gonna not be around for a bit.
Okay.
I think I would like to give Max some space. But after noticing that he'd left the group, I think Renji's going to look for him like after half an hour.
Oh, I was gonna give notes like twice as long as that.
Well, then you'll join half an hour later. Join him. Captions misgendered.
Oh no.
Sorry.
Anyway, Max will fly around a bit because he hasn't had the chance to fly recreationally yet. I will just like, you know, try out some things in the air a little bit and then just sit down on a roof somewhere and stare off into the distance.
How long do you think it'll take Renji to find him?
Is he checking the rooftops?
Probably.
When he does that.
Okay.
Max isn't hiding. but I get it. So you don't have to like roll perception checks. It's just that when you get up to the roofs, you'll find it.
I'll probably misty step up the roof because it's the easiest.
Yeah.
And walk over, you know, in view of Max. Sit down with him. And I think Renji would sit in silence with Max until he spoke up or until Hikan finds us.
So until Hikan finds us. Excellent.
Gotcha. That was entirely up to you.
Yep.
Fair enough. So you sit in quiet silence for a little bit. And then eventually you are found by Hikan.
I think the rooftops is one of the first places Hikan looks, actually.
So 20 minutes later.
Yeah.
I would like to roll an insight check on Max, if that would be okay. See if Max is looking for a quiet place, or if Max is nervous or self-conscious.
I do have something to say if you roll good.
Okay. And here we go. Nope.
Can I help?
I mean, Reggie could also roll inside.
Sure, but I don't think I'll be very good.
Can you beat a one?
You might not roll a one.
I might not, but I may. No, that's actually 23.
You know how Max gets when you guys get injured. When you guys disappear.
Mm-hmm.
Tyrina left. So he might be a bit weird about that.
Yeah.
He's just trying not to make things awkward by just not being there.
Mm-hmm. Might not be the best time to bring up, you know, what we'll do after saving the world.
Yeah, Les has not thought about that at all.
No.
I think, as Hikan didn't catch on that, I think the general idea that Hikan is getting is that people are looking for a moment alone, or at least to get away from things. And Hikan will offer to take them to the... It's a high peak, but it's the easiest one to climb, technically.
Mm-hmm.
Not that we need to worry about climbing for the most part.
I do have a limited amount of misty steps I can do.
I don't have a limit to flying.
Darn you, wings!
This is my vengeance for failing all those athletics checks to climb ropes.
Understood.
I never have to climb again.
Yeah, at those times it was like, yeah, roll a athletics check. How about I don't misty step?
But I think
will simply fail.
It's technically like 10 minutes away or so, and there's a little outcrop where if you look to your left you can see most of the expanse of a desert type of thing, and if you look to the right you can see an ungodly amount of Hyrule itself, a type of thing. And Nikon will just mention a this is where I would come when I wanted to sit and think for a while.
You guys can go catch up with her, you know. I'm fine by myself.
We'll have time. I mean, we still have to cross, like, the plains to the Gerudo Fortress, and, like, cross the mountains. We'll have plenty of time to catch up.
You say so.
I do.
She might think you're being rude, though, not hanging out with her.
Nah, Tarina has Mara and Zaiden. And a monastery full of, you know, other Shika, so...
Max looks at you with an expression like, is that a good thing?
I will return an expression like, I don't know.
Irina, Scott, I know she cares about all of us, and I know she'd be worried about you. So I just wanted to make sure people are okay, have the moments to figure some stuff out if necessary.
I'm fine, I'm just not sure I want to talk to her right now.
That's fair.
This is a tricky situation. I, in character and out of character, don't know
how to deal with this situation. Less will make it easy by standing up and taking flight.
That's worse, right?
I use the third charge of the brooch to... No, I'm kidding.
I shall simply exit the conversation.
No. Baldur's Gate 3 has ruined conversations.
Unfortunately, the dialogue options aren't appearing, so...
I think Akon will sit and watch Max fly around for about 5 minutes and then just shrug and go, you want some help down?
Honestly, I appreciate it.
Right.
And knowing that Max is out of earshot, we'll say to Akon, I don't think he's considered... what comes next.
What comes next after what?
You know, our tasks, our missions.
I got other things to find. I got stuff to put away, technically. I'm sure that as soon as we figure out a means to keep it locked away, they'll want to put it somewhere safe. At least try to make it something so that maybe only the hero can get it or something.
Yeah, hide them in places where, you know, traps, and, I don't know, maybe even put some monsters in so that, you know, a random passerby doesn't get stuff.
I mean,
maybe put a map and a compass in and you know, some keys in case you forget the ones you used. And
there's
maybe like a procedure or a process where if you beat like a very strong creature, then you can teleport to like the entrance. That'd be nice.
I was thinking for these, like putting them behind the untranslatable stone slate or something.
Untranslatable stone slates. That's why would you put untranslatable stuff? Like, what would it even be the point?
So as the future architects of our Zelda puzzles can converse on the way back down, and Max flies in solitude for a while. We cut back to where Tyrina, Mara, and Zaiden have been left, which is near one of the more or less the same like little tavern area that Goron had showed you beforehand. Mara's propped herself up with her armor near one of the walls, while Mara sits down at a table. She kind of fiddles with the necklace that was broken during the attack in Sarkoza, and Tyrina kind of looks over Mara briefly, and then looks over to you, Zaiden, and says, "So, I said this to you before the last time I paid a visit. I don't know exactly how much of the things have been fully told in the admittedly brief amount of time that I've been caught up. Anything I need to be aware of before we continue on?"
By the character, I'm not quite sure what she would need to know.
I'd say your passive insight's probably high enough for this. Basically, she's asking if there's like, if there's anything that the party has not told her that would be kind of a serious issue.
The Lynel.
Not just the Lynel. Like, is anybody in pain or dealing with anything that has just not been brought up since her arrival?
Zaiden would tell her about the things like the Lynel, the kind of general threats. But if, in terms of like people themselves having particular issues, he wouldn't just tell her their issues if they haven't volunteered the information.
Okay, that's fair. She kind of like nods a bit and says, "Okay. Yeah, makes sense. I mean, you're all still standing, so that's a good thing. I missed it. I really did. But I feel like I probably would have regretted it more if I stuck around as incapable as I was. You're still my friends and everything, and I'll do what I can to help. Never mind. I mean, there's... I wouldn't want to miss the chance of getting back at that guy. I guess just to assure stuff to myself, and she clank clank taps her chest with a gauntleted fist. Just so long as you guys are staying careful, right? Like, you're not putting yourself in too much danger, more than needs be for your station.
Aiden just thinks back to going to the Plane of Lament.
To be fair, didn't do that by choice. You were trapped.
Going to the Plane of Lament, becoming animals.
That means nothing to Zaiden. Zidane will nod. No, nothing too unexpected.
Destroying an entire zombie horde.
Shit, now I do want to see Tyrina's reaction to us turning into animals, like all of us. Because I want to know if Tyrina thinks that Renji is cute in some form. It's very important to know this.
Yeah.
But yeah, Tyrina will kind of give a bit of another nod and say, all right. If that's the case, then I will pry no more. When this is all over and I've finished my training, I will be tracking each of you down to talk to you. I promise that. I can't really go on without being able to know the full details as to what it is you guys got up to. I've been stuck in a desert temple for weeks and relearning everything that I seemingly forgot after everything had happened. I want to be able to hear stories of the outside. But I'm getting ahead of myself. And as she kind of like thinks on that, one of the other initiates comes up to your table and looks around for Hikan and clearly can't find him. And says, looks to you, Zidane, and says, I've been informed that the medallion is ready for your collection when you are ready. I was going to inform Master Sio, but unfortunately you can't seem to find him.
Biden will shrug and nod and say, well, I'll come get it now.
Thank you.
He'll get up to follow this person.
Tyrina face says, go on without me, I would really literally slow you down. Then you disappear, and then in the silence that exists between Tyrina and Mara, Tyrina kind of looks over in class, like looks over to Mara as she fiddles and stuff, and says, "You okay?" And Mara doesn't respond at first, until Tyrina goes, "Hey, Miss Fletcher." And Mara looks up, huh? Oh, yeah, sorry, distracted, that's all. Maria says, okay, I guess that answers my initial question. Want to talk about it? Mara just shakes her head and says, I think I'll be okay. No. You want to stay here, or we can make a brief detour, escort you back to Castletown if you need to. Mara shakes her head and says, No. I promise to be the group's chronicler and help them. I have to do that. And Tyrina just pauses at that statement, realizing it probably hurts more than Mara intended. And says, okay. Well, thank you for having the courage to do that. I know I impress this upon Zidane more than anyone, but can I ask you to make sure that they're taken care of after we have to part ways again? Because I can't imagine that I'll be able to do this by myself, to continue going with you guys like this after everything's done. I've still got training to do, and I don't know if I'm ready to face whatever this Nazgradar guy is. And Mara pauses a moment and says, I'll do my best. Thank you. And that is where we will end the session for today.
I want to know what the fuck is up with Mara.
Thank you, everybody, for listening/watching. I have been Articulate T. This has been episode 116 of Hyrule Chronicles. With me, as always, I have had Nether playing Renji Vox.
That was me and everyone else.
I have had Hikan Sio being played by Alvarance.
No, everyone else is Artie.
Oh, right. Sorry. You're right. Absolutely. I forgot.
I have had Rubber Pirate playing Zaiden Shari.
Bye.
And I have had Max being played by Keistrith.
Look at my boy making some drama.
Yeah. And we will see you folks next time. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye now.
Bye.